Well, good Sunday morning, church family, and happy Mother's Day to all the moms out there. It's so good to come to you one last time online before we regather back together a week from today. On May the 17th, it will be our first Sunday of phase one of the restarting process. So I trust you and I'm praying for you as you discern whether or not God would have you to go ahead and start coming back to church. Of course, if you have any compromised immunity, or certainly if you're showing any symptoms, please stay home. We will be broadcasting live, and I will be coming to you the way that I always do on a Sunday morning. But you prayerfully make that decision. If you need to wear a mask, please do. If that would make you feel more comfortable and safe here, we will be sanitizing the entire campus and especially those high traffic areas between the services. We're having service at the same time, 9 a.m. and 10:30, the same time as we had before. And we're going to use the same formats of the services. So whatever you were accustomed to before all of this pandemic began, we will try to keep it as close to normal as we possibly can. Now, when you come in, keep in mind that we are going to be a little stricter than we typically would. Our ushers will be guiding you to the seats so that we're using every other row of the church so that you don't have people right in front of you or right behind you. And we're going to put a little space between all of the families with two or three spaces between each family unit. You will need to sit together. The students won't sit at the front the way they typically do. We need you to sit with your family units so that we can just sort of control the spread of germs the best way that we can. Keep in mind, we have state-of-the-art HVAC systems in our main auditorium. So fresh air is being sent in to cool the auditorium perpetually. We're not recycling the air. So we believe we have a pretty safe environment and a good opportunity to kind of phase back into gathering. But again, we trust you to make that decision, and we will support whatever you decide to do person by person. So again, it's Mother's Day. I know we love our moms. I love my mother. As this is being broadcast, I am actually back in Alabama with my mother and my grandmother and my mother-in-law. We're all celebrating with them today, and we are just so thankful that technology allowed me to pre-record this so that I could broadcast it for you and also spend time with my mom. I know that you, if it's possible, you're doing the same. At least possibly you called her, FaceTimed with her, whatever it might be. And we've got some wonderful mothers in our community and in our church family. Some with little bitty children and some with grown children. And whatever your age may be, whatever your place in life, whether you're a mother, a grandmother, or great-grandmother, we want you to know that you're a valued part of our community and our church, and we love you, and we want to celebrate you today. And so I've chosen this text that is the words of Paul. It is the conclusion of our Paul series, but it was the word of Paul under the inspiration of God's Spirit to Timothy, his young protege in the faith. And in speaking to Timothy in this, his final letter, 2 Timothy, just before he is martyred for his preaching of Jesus Christ, he's going to reference the mother and the grandmother of this soon-to-be pastor, Timothy. We pick up in 2 Timothy 3, verse 10, and I'm going to read the first two words, and that will give you the title of today's message. You, however, that's the title. These two words, this qualifying conjunction, encapsulates the totality of a parent's will toward their children. When each of our three children were born, we gave them a special gift, a treasure, a little keepsake that they could have and keep throughout their life. Our second child, my son Cole, when he was born, I chose for him a little stopwatch. It was an antique style stopwatch, a gold stopwatch, like the railroad men used to carry. And I had engraved on the back of it the words of Proverbs 31, verse 4. And it says, "It is not for kings, O Lemuel, These were the words of Solomon's mother to Solomon to say, son, God is going to make a leader out of you. And as a leader, there will be things that the other boys can do that are not for you, that you don't need to be tangled up in. You need to live differently because God has a very unique path for your future. That's what Paul is communicating to Timothy in these two words when he says, now you, however. They reach back and draw a contrast over each of the previous adjectives that Paul had employed as he was describing the people of the last days. Here is how it can be understood. Let's look there in verse 1. But understand this, in the last days there will come times of difficulty, for people will be lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive. But you, however, they will be disobedient to parents in verse 2, ungrateful, unholy. But you, however, they will be heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good. But you, however, they will be treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. But you, however. So each of the you, howevers, is to be attached to the preceding adjective. And it is to qualify the adjectives that will follow after. Here's how it reads. You, however, have followed my teaching, my conduct, my aim of life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness. You, however, he says in verse 10, have followed, he goes on in verse 11, my persecutions, my sufferings that happened to me in Antioch, in Iconium, and at Lystra, with persecutions that I endured, yet from all the Lord rescued me. Indeed, all who live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted, while evil people and imposters will go on from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. Then he uses the phrase again. He says, but as for you. Now that's the same exact Greek construction as you, however. Now notice this contrast that Paul is drawing between the righteous and the ungodly. At times, we can so focus on the things that we have in common that we forget those profound differences that still exist. Both the righteous and the unrighteous may root for the same team in college football. Both the righteous and the unrighteous may draw fish out of the same body of water. Both the righteous and the unrighteous may dine in the same restaurant. But never, ever forget, there is a profound distinction between the two. And the difference is not found so much in their actions as it is in their heart attitude. This is reminiscent of the teaching of Jesus. Do you remember when Jesus taught specifically in a Sermon on the Mount, he did not say, some people pray, others do not pray. Nor did he say, some people give and others do not give. He didn't use that kind of phrasing, but rather he said, when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard by their many words. So Jesus said, both the godly and the ungodly pray. They just pray from a different heart attitude. The same is true with giving. He said in Matthew 6, 2, when you give to the needy, don't sound the trumpet before yourselves as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, seeking their praise from others. So in other words, he's saying, both give. Both give. Some give from the right heart attitude and some from a wicked heart attitude. So the essence of Christianity is not found in what you do or do not do, but it's found in the heart motive that drives you. Why do you pray? Why do you give? Now, how is Timothy to maintain this distinction, this proper heart attitude? Well, the key is his relationship to the Word of God, the Bible, the Scriptures. To reinforce this admonition to keep Timothy in the Scriptures, Paul is going to name a couple of his allies in discipleship. Now, he's done this from time to time. Back in 2 Timothy chapter 4, later in the book, in verse 1, when he calls upon Timothy to preach the word, he says it this way, "I charge you in the presence of God and Christ Jesus, preach the word." You see there, he's calling as witnesses. It's as if the Father and the Son are looking over his shoulder as he leans forward and says to Timothy, "Now preach the word." So here, he's going to do the same thing, but it's not the divine duo of the Father and the Son. Here, he calls on a different duo. It says in verse 14, "But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you have learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus." Now, who had taught Timothy the sacred writings from childhood? Well, Paul tells us in chapter 1, verse 5, when he said, "I am reminded of the sincere faith, a faith that dwelt first in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and now I am sure dwells in you as well." Now these two, Lois and Eunice, we're not sure if this was a mother and a daughter or a mother-in-law and a daughter-in-law. We don't know how their team was comprised. It could have been either. But rather than criticize and tear down one another, the two of them partnered against a common enemy. You know, one of the things you learn about leadership is that nothing unites a team better than clearly identifying who the enemy is and making sure that everybody knows it. Back around the year 1095, the Roman Empire had fallen and the Holy Roman Empire was trying to pull itself together, but you had different people who claimed to be emperor. You had different people who were claiming to be the Pope. And so it was fractioned and factious, and it was very difficult for any semblance of a movement to take place. That is, until Pope Urban II had a brilliant idea. He shifted the entire focus off of the Holy Roman Empire from the debates within to the enemy without. It's sort of like he said, "Have any of you guys noticed the Muslim Turks who have taken over the city of Jerusalem, the holy city?" And suddenly all of these landowners and all of these leaders in the Holy Roman Empire, the bishops, the people of prestige, the warlords, the knights, suddenly they quit looking at the Pope and they quit looking at the enemy across the table that was their own countrymen, and they began to look at the Turks back in Jerusalem. And that began a period known as the Crusades. And while they could not get along with each other, they could all agree that they didn't want the Muslims running Jerusalem. So they got together and they went to war. Nothing unites a people more than a common enemy. I think we saw that in the early days of this virus, did we not? It didn't matter whether you were independent or Republican or Democrat or Libertarian or whatever it might be. We all faced the same enemy of COVID-19. And at least for a few days, we were united in that effort. Things may not remain forever that way, but at least for a few days, we were united States of America. That's the same way I think of the enemies of Jesus. You had the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the publicans and all of these different people. They couldn't agree on anything, but they could all agree that they didn't like Jesus. So they came together against their common enemy. Well, we see the same thing here. You had a mother and a daughter who sometimes, mothers and daughters may not always get along that well. A mother-in-law and daughter-in-law may struggle all the more, but they had common goals and they had a common enemy. And so they went to war together. They united their forces. Lois and Eunice had that in common. We know nothing of the father or the grandfather. Maybe they were not on board, but mom and grandma took care of business. So many times this is the case. Well, four principles I want to give you out of the life of Lois and Eunice on this Mother's Day. Number one, they had the right source. It says in 2 Timothy 3:15, "And how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which were able to make you wise through faith, for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus." The sacred writings were the Word of God, the canon of Scripture. At that point, they had the Old Testament, the same Old Testament you have, and they had the beginnings of the gospel writings and some of the letters of the apostles. But the sacred writings, the authoritative source of divine revelation, Lois and Eunice used that as their source to convince and to train young Timothy. We live in a culture that likes to contract out responsibilities. You don't want to take care of your lawn, then you contract out that service. You don't want to clean your home, you contract it out. But when it comes to discipling your children, you dare not contract that out. We here have a wonderful staff. I'm so pleased with how this staff has led through the quarantine. We have people who are professionals like Josh and Christina that oversee our next generation ministries. And as professional as they are and as good as they are, you dare not contract out the discipleship of your children to anybody else. You take responsibility for it. Whether you're a father or a mother, own that responsibility. It must be yours. There will be a day when you will stand before Jesus Christ and you will give a measure of accounting for how you trained your children. Not for how they turned out, but what you did to give them what they needed. You say, "Well, Pastor, I didn't go to seminary. I'm not able to teach them the Bible." Friend, you don't have to go to seminary, and in many cases, it really hadn't done a lot of good for those who've gone. But if you want to be a good Bible teacher to your children, you just have to be about a week ahead of where they're at. If you've read a chapter ahead in the Jesus Storybook Bible, then you are ahead of your little girl if you're tucking a five-year-old in at night. Read ahead, learn a little more than they do, and help them to understand as you are gaining understanding. W.A. Criswell said it this way, "Possibly the most theologically accurate, intellectually deep, and morally inspiring song ever penned by the hands of a man went like this: Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." The Bible, the Word of God. Because the Bible tells me so, how can I know that the world was created in 6 days? The Bible tells me so. How can I believe that a flood destroyed the earth as it was and God recreated the earth? The Bible tells me so. How can I believe that forgiveness is possible and available? The Bible tells me so. How can I believe that if I confess my sins, that God is faithful and just to forgive me and cleanse me from all unrighteousness? Because the Bible tells me so. This is the source. Dear mothers, dear grandmothers, turn to this book in your times of difficulty. Celebrate this book in your times of victory. Quote it often. Sing about its truth. Stand on its authority. Trust its author. Let this be the source of your instruction. Number two, seek to convince. So not only have the correct source, seek to convince about the reliability of the source. In verse 14, he says, "But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you have learned it." That word firmly believed, pistuo, it means to make faithful, to render trustworthy, to make firm, to establish, or to firmly persuade. It means to convince someone that what you are saying is the truth. Lewis and Eunice did not just communicate the facts of the Word of God. They persuaded Timothy of their reliability. They became apologists. They likely had struggles and doubts from time to time that they had to learn to resolve, but rather than give in to their doubts, they sought answers. They dug deep. They talked to leaders. And in turn, they convinced their son, Timothy. The child who's raised up in this sort of home are like those mentioned in Colossians 1:23, where Paul says, he or she continues in the faith, stable and steadfast, not shifting from the hope of the gospel that they have heard. I want that to be said of my children. I want them to continue in the faith, steadfast. If I'm taken away today, I want my children to continue steadfast. So mother, do as Peter said in 1 Peter 3:15. Always be ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account of the hope that lies within you. You say, well, how do I do that? You read the apologist. You listen to podcasts. You equip yourself. Read C.S. Lewis' Mere Christianity. I believe every Christian needs to, of course, give their first attention to Scripture, but soon after that, get a copy of Mere Christianity and just get familiar with the writings of C.S. Lewis. Not so much for what it says, some of those things can be dated, but read Mere Christianity to learn how he approached the argument. Read Mere Christianity to learn how an apologist thinks. Where did he develop his confidence in the claims of the gospel and the truth of Christianity and the reliability of the Word of God? Listen to men like Ravi Zacharias. Become familiar with Answers in Genesis, answersingenesis.com. Go and let it reaffirm your convictions about the creation of the world. Buy good commentaries. Anticipate objections. And buy the commentaries that answer the objections as they are raised. Remember, hours out of every day, your children are sitting under the teaching of someone who may totally disagree with everything you stand for. Sometimes that's not true. Sometimes in this community, we have very godly and wonderful teachers. But at other times, in this community, and if not here, off at a college campus one day, they will sit before an agnostic, an atheist, who sees it as their moral obligation to tear apart your child's faith. And it's your job to equip them for that day. Don't delegate that out to a student ministry. You take responsibility, and then we here in the church and our student ministry will come alongside and assist you and help you. But you own that responsibility. Seek to convince. Find the right source. Number three, be patient. In chapter 3, verse 15, he says, "In that from childhood you have known the sacred writings." There are two mistakes I see when parents begin to teach their children the truth. One, they don't start early enough. He says, from childhood. And that means when you were in swaddling clothes. A newborn baby, when you put that baby to sleep, you sing him gospel lullabies. As you train up that child, surround them with the truth. I believe decorate their room with things that would remind them of the stories of Scripture. But one mistake is not starting early enough. The second mistake is stopping too soon. He says, from childhood. So here's what I see in the Baptist church so often. A parent starts out well. They decorate the little kid's room with Bible characters, and they read them the Jesus Storybook Bible, which if you have small children, get a copy of that. It's a storybook Bible that keeps Jesus at the center through every story. But they read them these kind of materials, and they sing Christian songs, and then that little kid goes off to youth camp one day and makes a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. And then mom and dad just sort of assume their job is complete. How many of you have learned your job is never complete? If you're a mom or a grandmother, you will always be a mom or a grandmother. Listen to me carefully. There will be a day when you will no longer be a wife. In heaven, we are like the angels, neither married nor given in marriage. That's why in our marriage ceremony, we say, till death do we part. You won't always be a wife. You won't always be a husband. But if you are a father, you will always be a father. If you're a mother, you will always be a mother. If you're a grandmother, you'll always be a grandmother. What a responsibility that is, and your job is never complete. You train those children, and then you encourage those children for the rest of your days. Paul would tell Timothy later in 2 Timothy 4:2, he says, preach the word, be ready in season and out of season. What does that mean? That means all the time. We await snapper season here on the coast, and we only get like 3 days here on the Atlantic side, but when those 3 days begin, snapper are in season. When they conclude, snapper are out of season. So you may catch one, but you got to release it. But all the time is either in season or out of season. So he's saying, preach the word at all times. And he goes on to say, with complete patience. As you teach, you have to teach, remembering that one of the great ministries that a person has is just the ministry of repetition, reminding people. You know, I've learned as a pastor that it's not the sermon itself that people will remember. Many of the points I give, you won't remember. To be quite frankly honest with you, I don't remember half of them. But what you do remember are those things that make it into every sermon. Over time, you kind of see what the pastor bleeds for. You kind of see what he's serious about. And those things that make it into every sermon, that's what you remember. And in the same way, the things that you teach your children, let me tell you something, those of you who got those babies up and got them somewhat dressed and gathered them together to watch the sermon today in your living room, you may think that those boys and girls are not paying attention. Two of them may be fighting right now, and if they are, they need to quit it. But I'm telling you, I feel your pain. I understand some of you moms probably feel like it's not doing a bit of good, but you listen to me, it's doing a lot of good. You're serving those children well. You're teaching them right. They will remember that it was important to you. Each of these Sundays during quarantine, they'll look back one of these days and they'll tell their kids, they'll say, you know, I remember even through that quarantine we had to go through, Mama made me get up every Sunday and sit down and listen to the Word of God. Here's probably what they'll say. I don't even remember who the preacher was, but I remember it was important to my mother. Those are the things you do with great patience that they will remember over the long haul. Number four, live the message. He says in verse 14, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you have learned it. The whom qualifies the what. Lois and Eunice had lived the sacred writings. John Maxwell said it this way, I teach what I know. I reproduce what I am. Jesus said, when a disciple has been fully taught, he becomes like his teacher. Every true learner asks the question when they hear the teaching, well, what does that look like in real life? And you, dear mother, are a living epistle. You are a living illustration of the truth. You must be able to say with Paul, follow me as I follow Christ the best I know how. Susanna Wesley was a great mother. She was the mother of 19 children. Let that sink in for a moment. Among those 19 children, you obviously, if you have 19 kids, surely one or two will turn out okay. But among those 19 children were John and Charles Wesley, the founder of Methodism, the Methodist Church, as well as the Wesleyan Church. It has been said that the Methodist faith was born on the lap of a mother, Susanna Wesley. One of her prayers she jotted down went like this. It gives you a glimpse into how she thought. She said, help me, Lord, to remember that religion is not to be confined to the church or the closet, nor exercised only in prayer and meditation, but everywhere that I am in your presence. May all things instruct me and afford me an opportunity of exercising some goodness and daily learning and growing toward your likeness. I heard of one man who began his prayer in the morning with his head bowed, and he said, dear Lord, and he voiced his prayer, but he did not add the amen until his day was complete. And just as he laid his head on the pillow, he said, in Jesus' name, amen. Your entire life is that of a Christian. It can no more be relegated to the church than anything else. You must take it with you everywhere you go. You're a Christian mom. If you're a business owner, you're a Christian business owner. If you're a politician, you are a Christian politician. And there are Christian politicians. But whatever you are, you must be a Christian in what you do, and take that child by the hand and say, follow me as I follow my Lord. Your life is the gospel without parable and without hyperbole. If you remember last week, we raised the question, if you had the cure for this disease, this virus, COVID-19, and we asked if you had it, would you tell other people? Would you try to convince them that you had the cure? And we said, of course you would. If you're a decent human being, you would convince them that the cure you held was the correct cure and they needed to take it immediately. And in the same way, if you have the gospel, you ought to preach the gospel. Well, let me look at that from a little different direction. Suppose someone came up to you and they said they had the cure for COVID-19. But then as they handed it to you, they coughed and they fell over dead. What would you think of their cure? I don't think I would take it. Well, in the same way, preaching the gospel and living the Christian life are like two wings on an airplane. You can't have one without the other. You got to present the truth if anybody's going to understand, believe, and be saved. But you got to live the truth if anybody's going to take it seriously. Dear Mother, on this Mother's Day, have the right source. You be a mother of the book. Convince your children of its reliability. Be patient with them. Teach them over and over and over these things. And then you do your best to endeavor to live out the message. That doesn't mean you're going to be perfect, but it means when you mess up, and you will, that you confess it, that you're humble about it, and you take it before God and admit it before your family, and then you keep right on following Jesus. And as you do, I hope this is the best Mother's Day you've ever had. I can't wait to see you next week, May the 17th, either the 9 a.m. or the 10:30 a.m. service. We're going to be back in the building. You come early and find you a seat. And let me encourage you, be ready to sing like you've never sang before. be ready to study the Word like you've never studied it before, to pray like you've never prayed before. Let's remember what we have. I know I've missed it, and I trust that you have as well. For those of you who aren't able to be there, or maybe you just don't have the comfort to be there just yet, we totally understand. And we encourage you, continue to watch online and to join us for this broadcast each week. May God bless you, and you have a wonderful week.